Welcome to St. Paul's Lutheran Church's Weekly Worship Podcast. As always, we're broadcasting from beautiful Grand Island, Nebraska. The following traditional worship service was recorded on Sunday, January 29, 2017, at our 9 o'clock service. The sermon was delivered by Pastor Bill Pavuk. Please visit us online at www.stpaulsgi.com.
God is good. Welcome to our worship this morning, and we are grateful to have Pastor Schambach back in the building. Pastor Ed has been under the weather. We're going to do a theme song. No. Okay. Pastor Edgar has been under the weather throughout this week, and while his health is returning, his voice is not yet back with us. But we're glad to have him here with us. His affliction is not contagious, so just know that you are safe, as always, in his care. But we are grateful to have him back with us, and we look forward to our ministry today. A couple of reminders. This morning, I will begin a study called Partnering with the King, and any who wish to participate in this study that will be continuing over the next 6 weeks on the Gospel of Matthew, you're invited to join me at 10 in rooms 13 and 14. I'll be sharing materials, and we'll be getting started with our introductory video for that study. Also today, following our 11 o'clock worship service, will be our annual meeting. A lot of ministry, a lot of business of the church to take care of, some voting, some leadership positions in the congregation to be decided at this meeting, and look forward to everyone joining us and participating, joining us for the potluck meal, and also for all of the work and the celebrations that we will get to share in this afternoon. I invite you to keep in your prayers those hospitalized recently, including Mary Reimers, Keisha Folk, Rose Nehans, Donna Merklin, Marianne Nelson, Dale Peer, David Woods, Tom Schwieger, and Jerry Bryant. We also continue to hold in our prayers and extend our sympathies to the family of Jan Meyer. Jan passed away last weekend. Services for Jan were this past Friday here at the church. And we also extend our prayers and our condolences to Pete Richling at the death of Pete's father, Doc. With that, I invite you to turn in your bulletin to our order for confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who stretches out the heavens, who sends light to the nations, who gives breath to us all. And now let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Loving God, we confess that we have turned from your way to follow our own ways. Forgive us for the times we have spoken or acted too quickly. We have not spoken or acted at all. We have hurt those closest to us. We have hurt those we have yet to know. We have thought more about ourselves than others. We have thought less of ourselves than we ought. Turn us around and give us a fresh start so that we can live again as your children. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, even when we have done wrong, God makes us right. Even when we have messed up, God puts us together. God's love never runs out. God never tires of calling us beloved children. Hear God say to you now, your sins are forgiven for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. God's people say, Let us rise up and sing our processional song. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord be with you. Holy God, you confounded the world's wisdom in giving your kingdom to the lowly and the pure in heart. Give us such a hunger and a thirst for justice and perseverance in striving for peace, that in our words and deeds the world may see the life of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Congregation, may be seated.
Oh, let us I invite the children to come forward for a time for them. Almost invited the congregation up. That would have been weird. Come on up, kids. Hey, Madison. Hi, Olivia. Brooke.
Good morning.
Something up here with me.
What do we have here? What does that look like?
Oh, hey guys, have a seat. What does that look like? I mean, it's really small print, but what does that look like to you? Have you seen something like that before?
Da, da, da.
This is a recipe. I brought a recipe with me today. And even though the biggest picture on these two pages for some reason is an ad for hot wings, this is actually a recipe for brownies. I know, but, you know, I mean, it's the biggest thing there. But I brought a recipe for brownies. You guys like brownies? Yeah! I didn't make them, though. I'm sorry. That's the bad news. But wanted to bring that in because, you know, because recipes help us make things. Now, sometimes, some people who are really, really good, sometimes they don't need recipes. They know just how much. They know just how much to add. And sometimes we can take recipes and we can say, well, it says I should use a teaspoon of this, but I like it a lot, so I'm going to throw a couple tablespoons in there. So, you know, recipes can be played with sometimes, but the idea behind recipes is that if you follow it step by step, usually you're going to come out with what you need. And there's an order to how you do things. Like here it says, did you know that there's eggs in brownies? Did you know that? Yeah. There's a few eggs in brownies. This one has four eggs in it. And fortunately, the recipe tells us that you mix it with the other stuff. You mix the eggs in with the other stuff before you bake it, which is a good thing because I'm pretty sure that if you made the brownies without the eggs and then you broke the eggs over the top of the brownies, I'm pretty sure that would be extremely disgusting, right? Yeah. Yeah, that would mess things up a little bit. So sometimes, you know, you can play with the recipe here and there, but some parts of the recipe are really, really important. some parts of the recipe are really, really important, like the eggs. You need to put the eggs in the right spot. That'll ruin everything if you don't. Well, I brought a recipe in today. I brought a recipe in today because in our Bible story this morning, Jesus is talking to his disciples. Jesus is talking to his disciples about places where they can find God's blessing. Places where they can find God's blessing. And he sort of gives them a recipe. He sort of gives them a recipe for finding God's blessing and making God more a part of their lives and being closer to God in their lives. And he gives them this recipe to follow. Now, like I said, with recipes, sometimes we play with things and sometimes we add things or subtract things and move things around. But in the Bible story today, Jesus gives his disciples, some directions and some ideas on how they can make a good relationship with God and with other people. So I'm going to be sharing that with all of us today for us to think about and for us to remember. So sometimes Jesus gives us a recipe. And when Jesus gives us a recipe, it's probably one that we can trust and that we should try to follow. Can you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we thank you for your light, for your grace, and for revealing to us the nature and the heart of God and his great love for the world. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, thanks for coming up.
Our reading this morning is from Micah chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. Hear what the Lord says. Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the controversy of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a controversy with his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? To what have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of slavery. And I sent you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember now that King Balaam of Moab devised what Balaam, the son of Beor, answered him. And what happened from Shittim to Gilo, that you may know the saving acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God? The word of the Lord.
Please stand. Gospel according to St. Matthew in the 5th chapter. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. And then he began to speak, and he taught them. saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." This is the living gospel of Jesus Christ. You may be seated. Peace of the Lord be with you. A lot of attention is given to last words in life. Heard a message from a hospice worker this past week. She was speaking on a news show, and she said that she was asked about that more than anything else when she shares with people what she does. People wanted to know what sorts of things she heard in the final moments, final hours, final minutes of a person's life. With Christ, we reflect each year during Holy Week on those final days and those final words in His life, those significant final hours, the Last Supper, the last commandment, love one another as I have loved you, the washing of the feet, all of those last instructions that were so critical for Jesus and His disciples. Last words are not always that profound because not everybody knows that they're going to be their last words. But with the Lord, in the final days, it was clear. So those final commandments and instructions are profoundly important to us. In Matthew's Gospel, the Beatitudes that we hear today are, as Matthew has set up his message to us, they are the first words. These are the first real teachings that Jesus gives to His followers. Now, first impressions aren't always what we hope that they'll be. First words, some of them are more memorable than others. A lot of them aren't held on to for long. But I think we should pay significant attention to these first instructions, how Jesus lays the groundwork, how Jesus introduces His disciples to the kingdom of God, and how these Beatitudes shape the course of His ministry, shape the course of our calling as well. These words begin the Sermon on the Mount. It was one of the longest collections of Jesus' teachings offered in the Gospel. In fact, probably apart from the final chapters in John's Gospel. Apart from the final words, the first words were most significant in terms of quantity, portion of teaching that Jesus gives. Christ begins with these blessings. Blessings that defy the expectations of His time. It was thought at that time, if you're lacking in faith, if you're lacking basic needs, if you're burdened with sadness and loss, if you're struggling, if you're living in constant fear and in constant terror, You're not blessed. In fact, God has certainly forgotten about you. That was common understanding. Jesus flips all of that on its head. Are you troubled in spirit, mourning? Blessed. Are you often overlooked and forgotten? Are you undervalued? Are you finding no place? Are you finding doors being shut on you? You are blessed. Are you always giving others the benefit of the doubt and finding them taking a mile every time you give them an inch? You are blessed. Do people say you're too honest for your own good? Always trying to keep the peace? Always seem to be getting punished for doing right? You are blessed. Jesus presents his disciples with encouragement for taking the path of greater resistance. It's an invitation to a path of need and hunger, humility and grace. To sum it up, to sum up these Beatitudes, blessed are the ways of love. Blessed are the ways of love. But these ways of love, they can be brutal. Mourning, hunger, thirst, overwhelmed, opposed by others. I mean, these things find us all. They do catch up to us, and we all experience them from time to time. We get bravely over them with God's help, but to call them a gift, to seek them out? This is something new for the disciples, and it's still a bit strange to us too. The drive for self-preservation is strong in us. That little voice saying, we just don't have room. We just don't have anything left to give. We don't need to be sucked into those other people's problems. We don't need to make ourselves a part of their grief, their injustice, their trials, their loss. It's a persistent thing. It's a persistent thing. It's a natural thing. There's a logic to it. But logic doesn't bring us victory. On the TV show, the TV series Doctor Who, it's a race of cyborgs called the Cybermen that the Doctor does battle with. Cybermen originated from this plan to perfect the human race. There was this idea that someone had that the reason why we're always failing, the reason why things always fall apart, we just have too much emotion, we just have too much pathos. We just have too much care and concern and feeling. So if we could just rid ourselves of that, if we could just become automated with logic and reason, if we could just replace that emotion and that feeling, then humanity could truly rule the universe. That was the plan. It's a nightmarish scenario with terrifying consequences. But there are great lengths that we sometimes go so that we don't have to know the need, so that we don't have to carry the sorrow, so that we don't have to get entangled in quests for justice and righteousness. As I said earlier, for the disciples, seeing these things as a blessing was strange and unusual. But Jesus is explaining to them that this is the core of who we are. We're not wired or created to live like cyborgs. We are wired for community. We are wired to get enmeshed in the chaos and the needs and the fragility of life. We're wired, quite simply, to love. And as I've said to many of you at one time or another, and I shared it with Jan Meyer's family on Friday morning. To quote the late, great Colonel Sherman T. Potter, sometimes love brings us trouble. Sometimes loving others is going to leave us feeling depleted and poor in spirit. Sometimes love is going to give us grief. Sometimes love is going to humble us. Sometimes it gets us in trouble. But it also always puts us in the path of God's activity. These blessings are a blessing because they place us. They place us where God needs us to be. They place us in the mindset and in the posture that we need to be in to receive and to hear and to recognize what God has to show us. The one thing about the Beatitudes that I think we miss sometimes because of the rewards that Jesus talks about is that even without the promise of being filled, without the promise of the kingdom, without the promise of inheriting the earth, or I should say before these things, what is talked about here is still a blessing. As the writer Owen Stepp described it, you cannot mourn without appreciating how insufficient you are to handle life on your own strength. You can't be meek unless you know you have needed gentleness yourself. You cannot hunger and thirst for righteousness if you proudly think of yourself as already being righteous. You cannot be merciful without recognizing your own need of mercy. You cannot be a peacemaker if you believe that you are always right. In these truths, apart from any of the quid pro quo assurances that Jesus gives in the Beatitudes, there is blessing. There is blessing in this life. There is blessing in a mind and a heart that is oriented towards the image and the purposes and obedience to God's grace. Peace be with you. Amen. Invite the congregation to stand as we sing. together with our brothers and sisters in faith across continents and across centuries, with the whole church, we confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Called to be a light to the nations, let us pray for God's justice, peace, and healing. Merciful Lord, we pray for wholeness in the body of Christ, that you would bind up the fractures within the church, within communities, and between communities. Humble the proud and lift up the lowly. Make us one at your table. Bless our leaders in the church, especially our bishops, Brian and Elizabeth, in their work. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. We pray for all working towards peace around the world. We pray for all who stand up, sacrifice, and give of themselves to bring an end to violence. We pray for those charged with our nation's protection and security, as that you would guide their decisions. And also in this time, we pray for Lutheran Immigration and Refugee Services and the countless others who carry out the call in the ministry of settling refugees throughout the world. Be with us as brothers and sisters as we seek to find a balance, and as we work to proclaim mercy and hope and help these things to triumph over fear. Hear us, O God. We pray for our neighbors, for those who mourn. We pray for those who, unlike us, have no clean water and who hunger and thirst for sustenance. Provide their daily bread. Heal the forgotten. Be present with the lost. Reconcile us with our enemies. And lift up all who are broken. Hear us, O God. We give you thanks for this congregation, for the ways that we feed one another, for the ways that we feed Grand Island, for the ways that we proclaim and shine your light in our vocations, in our work, in our play, throughout our daily lives. Bless our work, deepen our faith, expand our discipleship. Equip us always to do justice, love kindness, walk humbly with you. Hear us, O God. Receive these prayers in the name of Christ, the light of the world, who is one with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Just take a moment to share the peace of Christ with those around us. Congregation, please stand. Merciful God, receive the gifts we bring, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Through this meal, unite us as your body, shining with the light of your justice and mercy, for the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all of the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, in whom you have revealed yourself, our light and our salvation. You sent a star to guide wise men to where the Christ was born, and your signs and witnesses in every age and through all the world have led your people from far places to his light. In his baptism and in table fellowship, he took his place with sinners. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, recovering sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. And on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Together we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. With this bread and cup, we remember your word dwelling among us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection. We look with hope for his coming. Come on, Jesus.
Holy God, we long for your Spirit. Come among us. Bless this meal. May your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light. Bring the gift of peace on earth. All praise and glory are yours, Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, Power of the Most High, one God now and forever. Amen. We join with one another as a family of faith as we pray in the words that our Savior taught. Our Father, congregation may be seated. We who are many are one body as we partake of this one bread. Come and be filled with light and life. All are welcome. Please stand. May the body and the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen. We pray together. O morning star, fair and bright, you have refreshed us again with heavenly food. You are our dearest treasure. Go with us now, today, tomorrow, every day, that we tell the story of your never-ending love and sing your praise both now and forever. Amen. The God of glory dwell in you richly. Name you beloved. Shine brightly on your path. The blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Now go in peace and be the light of Christ.
Thank you for worshiping with us at St. Paul's Lutheran Church. For more information about our church, to listen to previous episodes, or to find our Facebook and Twitter pages, please go to www.stpaulsgi.com.